Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Silverman, and this is Turning Point, and we're here to lead the worship. And let's open up with a prayer. Lord, we thank you and praise you for this time. It's good to be in your presence. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. We welcome your presence to be here in our midst as we worship you, as we listen to your word. We pray that you would use us as effective ministers of your good news all throughout this campus, throughout this region, throughout this world. In the name of Jesus, amen. Our prelude this morning is the last words of David. Please stand and join us in singing 10,000 Reasons.
Like never before.
is a way maker. He makes a way where there seems to be no way. He's the God who's able to do miraculous things. Amen. He's able to do impossible things. And this is one of the reasons, just one of the reasons why we give him praise. When the chorus comes around, please sing along with us. And the chorus is the part that says, way maker. Sing along.
Waymaker.
There we go.
'Cause I know that you know how. For I know that I can call you. Yes, I know that you'll be there. You're the source of all creation. I'm so glad that you care. Waymaker. Waymaker.
I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. Here we go.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me.
Jesus lifted me, I'm so glad.
Jesus lifted me, I'm so glad. Jesus lifted me, I'm so glad. Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me.
Ask me not, O gentle Savior. Well, thank you, Turning Point, for leading us again in music and worship and song and sharing your gifts and your talents with all of us. It's interesting that to me that four times in New Testament scripture, the Apostle Paul primarily speaks that God gives gifts to individuals. Now, our speaker this morning, Pernell Jones, is the Chief Financial Officer and Vice President here at Eastern University, which means is that he manages all of our finances. But the gifts that God has given him are way beyond just being able to count. He does get the numbers, but from my perspective is he has a significant gift of wisdom. And whenever he's given devotions, and he was one of the people that sort of gave a speech on the values of that we have of faith, reason, and justice at the opening convocation, all of them who did it did such a spectacular job, but he did particularly insightful in what he had to say, and he's one of my leaders who I work most closely with, and he always has a wise word to say in an often soft but yet penetrating way. A gift to us and a gift to me, and of all the gifts that Pernell has, I so appreciate our gift of friendship. So let me introduce to you someone who works a lot behind the scenes that you may not know, but someone who has an extraordinary role here at Eastern University, Pernell Jones, our Chief Financial Officer.
Thank you, Mr. President, for those generous words. So when your boss is the president, and a theologian, and a preacher, and you're scheduled to speak at chapel, it'd have been okay if he was scheduled to be out of town today. Pray with me. I thank you, God, for these who have gathered here to worship you and to hear your word. I surrender the words of my mouth to you. I pray that you will bless them, that you will break them, that they might nourish them and me, so that we might serve you well. Pray this in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. So last week was spring break at our house. My wife, Tangela, and I have two boys, Joshua, age 15, a freshman at Radnor High School, and Jaden, age nine, is a third grader at Radnor Elementary. And from Saturday, March 19th through Sunday, March 27th, both boys just straight up chilled, indulging in their freedom from school. No alarm clocks ringing at 5:30 in the morning, no scrambling to catch the school bus, no homework. They stayed in their pajamas until well past noon, watching television, playing video games, board games, munching on Nutella and banana sandwiches. They were living the life. The little one was so excited that from time to time, he would just start dancing and singing. Watch me whip, watch me nay nay. I'm glad y'all know what that's about because I don't have a clue. Both boys thoroughly enjoyed their spring break. But here's the thing about spring break. It always comes to an end. And then the week after. Needless to say, conditions around our house have not been as jovial as they were last week. I'm guessing it started around 4:30 or 5 o'clock p.m. on Sunday. The euphoria that had coursed through their veins for nine glorious days was suddenly and spontaneously flushed away, only to be replaced by the moody blues. They grew tense and mildly irritable. Their brains, which had been in hibernation mode, suddenly switched back on. And they suddenly remembered homework assignments that 9 days before they swore did not exist. And Monday morning, when that 5:30 alarm clock went off, the whipping and nay-naying was replaced by wailing and gnashing of teeth. Welcome to the week after. Of course, this is the week after for another momentous occasion, particularly for those of us that are Christian believers. Last week was Holy Week, a time that we punctuated this past Sunday by our celebration of Resurrection Day, our celebration of the good news that Jesus is alive. The temple veil has been torn asunder, and we have been reconciled to the Father and ushered into his presence. Since August, our chaplain, Joe Modica, has challenged us with the question, what is the gospel? And with us having just celebrated the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, I can't think of a more appropriate time to contemplate that. The second chapter of Ephesians is one of those passages in my Bible that's bookmarked and highlighted every verse. I believe that the first 9 verses of that chapter render an exceptional response to the question, what is the gospel? Reading from the English Standard Version. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, and because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. The thesis: due to sin and depravity that reigns upon this earth and thus reigned in us, we were dead and separated from the Father. The antithesis to our depravity is the great love of the Father, meted out to us through an abundance and overflow of his mercy and his grace. And the synthesis of those two facts is the never-ending sacrifice and victory of Jesus, our Redeemer, the only begotten of the Father. What is the gospel, the good news of God? It is Jesus, wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, chastised for our peace. By his stripes we were healed. And that the Father raised him from the dead, and he is seated even now at God's right hand, we too are alive and raised together with Christ, seated in heavenly places. That is good news indeed. With this being the week after Holy Week, I've been prompted to think about the reactions and emotions of Jesus' disciples following his resurrection from the grave and his ascension 40 days later to heaven. Think about it. For a scant 3 years, they followed Jesus, listening with rapt attention as he ministered to people in the synagogue and in their homes and along the streets and by the seaside. They watched, barely believing their eyes, as he healed the sick, restored sight to the blind, called the lame to walk, even invoking the dead to return to life. They struggled to understand the lessons from the parables that he taught and the revelations that he wrought pertaining to his death and to their roles in the kingdom of God. Then, in what must have been the most remarkably gut-wrenching few days of their lives, they watched from the front row as this Jesus, their teacher, the chosen one sent of God, was arrested, tried, convicted, sentenced, derided, brutalized, crucified, buried. Then 3 days later, risen from the grave. The first chapter of Acts indicates that after his sufferings, Jesus presented himself alive to his disciples through many proofs over a span of 40 days. He then charged them to remain in Jerusalem for the promise of the Father, the Holy Spirit, after which they were to give evidence to the good news that Jesus is alive in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And when Jesus had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. What must the disciples have thought? What must they have felt? Their leader, their teacher, the chosen one sent from the Father, quietly ascended up to heaven, and the weight of advancing the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, resting squarely upon their shoulders. The 10th verse of Acts chapter 1 indicates that after Jesus ascended into the clouds, the disciples just stood there, gazing intently into the sky. I can only imagine the deer in the headlights look of bewilderment upon their faces. It probably wasn't much different than the look on my son's faces when the alarm clock went off at 5:30 Monday morning. The etymology of the word gospel traces back to the Old English word godspell, whose literal translation is good story, or the story of God. The word gospel is also rendered from the Greek word euangelion, which means a good message. Euangelion is the foundation for the word that we know as evangelism, which correlates perfectly with Jesus' charge to his disciples to bear witness to him in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the ends of the earth. When Jesus charged his disciples to be his witness, I believe that he was compelling them to much more than a verbal recounting of his life. A witness renders evidence of what he knows or believes to be true. And while the rendering of that evidence may very well be verbal, it should also be rendered by the tread of our feet and the labor of our hands and the embrace of our arms. I believe that the gospel, the story of God, the good news, is not only the act of redemption that was wrought from Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. I believe that it is also the consequences of that redemptive act as borne out in the lives of Christian believers. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 substantiates my belief, I think. Remember the preface that I shared with you minutes ago from verses 1 through 9. We were dead as a result of trespasses and sins, but God, because he is rich in mercy and because of his great love, he made us alive together in Christ, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace toward us in Christ Jesus. And here's verse 10. As a result, we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. The implication of our redemption that Jesus paid for on the cross is that we are his workmanship, created in him for his good work. For a world that is broken, lost, and in peril, we must be the gospel. We must embody the good news that is Jesus Christ. I love the way that Jesus depicts this call in our lives in his Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, verses 13 through 16 from the Message Bible. Let me tell you why you are here. You're here to be salt, seasoning that brings out the God flavors of this earth. If you lose your saltiness, how will people taste godliness? Here's another way to put it. You're here to be light, bringing out the God colors in the world. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under a bucket, do you? I'm putting you on a light stand. And now that I've put you there on a hilltop, on a light stand, shine. Keep open house. Be generous with your lives. By opening up to others, you'll prompt people to open up with God, this generous Father in heaven. We are the gospel of Jesus Christ, his workmanship, created in him for good work that he prepared for us before the world began, empowered by the Spirit of God to be the light of the world and the salt of the earth. Okay, so I said all of that to you so I can say this. Really my primary objective standing here this morning. But before I say it, I got to tell you that I feel a little foolish saying it. It's one of those axiomatic statements that's so obvious on its face that it barely warrants mentioning. When I get done, you're going to be wondering, why in the world did you feel the need to say that? But here it is. If we are the light of the world, doesn't it stand to reason that God has called us to circumstances and situations that are in need of illumination? If we are the salt of the earth, doesn't that mean that we will often find ourselves in conditions or circumstances that are distasteful, unsavory, and not so desirable? See, I can see it on your faces. You're wondering, why in the world would he say something like that? Just like saying water is wet. Well, I'll tell you why I'm saying it to you today. Because in spite of all my years in the faith, all the time that I've spent studying scriptures, in spite of how close I perceive I am to God and abiding in his will, more times than not, I shrink in the face of challenges. I recoil at difficulties. I cringe in the face of circumstances that are dark or distasteful. I've been the light in a well-lit room before, and I got to tell you, I kind of like it. I don't have to pray as much. I don't have to be so diligent in my Bible study. I can passively trust God instead of aggressively trusting God. But God did not appoint his only begotten Son to the brutalities of the cross so that we could be a light in a well-lit room. God appointed Jesus to the cross so that we could be redeemed from sin and trespass, so that the temple veil could be torn asunder and we could enter the presence of the Most High God. God appointed Jesus to the brutality of the cross so that we could become the good news of Jesus Christ, his workmanship created for good work that he prepared for us before the world began. Salt and light to a world that is broken and lost and in peril. Salt and light to circumstances and conditions that are darkened and frayed and uncertain. So before, the thesis of our lives was that we were dead due to sin and trespass. But through Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, that thesis has been rewritten. And now we are salt and light. The antithesis to that is that we inhabit, have been appointed to, a world that is lost and broken and in peril. But the synthesis of those two is unchanged. It is still Jesus, our Redeemer, who, having conquered death and grave, is at the right hand of the Father, making intercession on our behalf. He prophesied to this very dialectic in John 16, verse 33, when he said, "In this world you will have tribulation, but don't sweat it. I have overcome the world." My challenge to you today is first and foremost a challenge to myself. Don't sweat it. Don't shrink in the face of challenges. Don't recoil at difficulties. Don't cringe when confronted with circumstances that are darkened or distasteful. Let us boldly inhabit the calling, the heritage that was won for us on the cross. We have been made alive, raised together with Christ, and seated in heavenly places. We are the good news of Jesus Christ. We are salt and light, his workmanship carefully crafted to be the good, to bring the good to conditions and circumstances that are darkened and frayed and dying. Let me tell you why you are here. You're here to be salt, seasoning that brings out the God flavors of this earth. You're here to be light, bringing out the God colors in this world. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, I am putting you on a light stand. I've put you there on a hilltop. So shine. Keep open house. Be generous with your lives. By opening up to others, you will prompt them to open up with God, our generous Father in heaven. Dear God, my prayer for us all is that we will embody this.